Hello, scientists. Caroline here. Today's mission? Help me improve Justin's chocolate chip cookie recipe. I've got all the ingredients and tools, but there's just one issue. I need to practice my metric system measuring skills to make sure my cookies turn out better than Justin's last batch. Can you help me? Awesome. Today, we'll take accurate measurements for length, mass, and volume. We'll also decide on the best unit to use for our measurements so we can easily communicate our data with other scientists. In this video, I'll walk you through some of the activities in this lab, and you'll have a chance to try them on your own at home as we go. Before you continue with this video and lab activity, pause here to read over the safety information, materials, and lab procedure in your interactive lab notes with a parent or guardian. Once you have your parent or guardian's permission, you can use your own materials at home to follow along with me. As we work through the lab, feel free to pause the video if you need more time or to rewind the video if you need to see one of the steps again. If you can't complete the lab at home, no problem. Watch this video and record the measurements you observe. Are you ready, scientists? Let's get started. You should have already read through the lab procedure and collected the necessary materials. So let's take a moment to get all of these materials organized and ready. Our most important materials today will be our measurement tools. We'll be taking three kinds of measurements in the metric system today. Do you remember what they are? Today we'll measure mass, length, and volume, and we'll need special tools for each. To measure mass, you'll need an electronic scale. A food scale that measures in grams would be best, but a body scale that measures in kilograms will also work. Your scale may currently be set to measure in pounds or ounces, but digital scale models usually have a button somewhere that changes the units. Make sure to change the unit on your scale to grams or kilograms so that it's metric. Kitchen scales usually have a button to do this right next to the screen, and body scales usually have a button on the bottom or side. The next measurement we'll practice is length. Instead of using inches or feet, though, we'll be measuring in the metric system. Most tools for measuring length have two different sides, one for inches or feet and one for centimeters or meters. A tape measure will work best, but you could also use a ruler or meter stick. Finally, we'll measure volume, or how much space something takes up. In the last video, we practiced calculating the volume of a cube. We also learned that for liquids, scientists use milliliters or liters to measure volume. Today, we'll practice measuring volume with water. Then we'll use a technique called the displacement method to measure the volume of irregularly shaped solids. For these measurements, you'll need a graduated cylinder. If you only have some of these tools, feel free to complete the measurements you can and watch the video for the ones you aren't able to do. Let's start with measuring mass. Mass tells us how much matter is in an object. Scientists measure this in grams or kilograms using a digital balance. The unit you use depends on the size of the object and the type of scale you have. Lighter items are measured in grams. If you have a food scale that measures in grams, it's best to measure small, lighter items like raisins or an apple. Heavier items are measured in kilograms. If you only have a body scale that measures in kilograms, you'll want to pick heavier items like a bag of flour or a pair of shoes. Remember, we want to use the right tool for the job. Measuring a raisin with a bathroom scale probably won't be very accurate, and weighing boots on a food scale might be too heavy. Based on your scale, select three items that are best suited for your units. I have a food scale, so I've selected a pair of glasses, a tennis ball, and a cereal bowl. Pause the video here to write each of your objects in this table in your interactive lab notes. then hypothesize the mass of each object. A raisin is about 1 gram, and a pineapple is about 1 kilogram. What do you predict the masses of your 3 items will be? Now that you've made your predictions, let's test them out by taking accurate measurements. Make sure the scale is on a flat, stable surface. If it's wobbly or tilted, your measurements might be off. Before you place your first item on the scale, make sure your scale is starting at 0. If you have a 0 or tear button, press that to be sure that you're starting at 0. Once you've zeroed your scale, set your first item on the center. Wait 5 seconds to let the mass settle. Then record the mass in your data table. Make sure to include the units you used. Repeat this procedure to measure the mass of your next 2 items. Zero your scale in between each item to make sure your measurements are accurate. Be sure to leave your scale on a stable surface the whole time. As you complete each measurement, fill out the measurements in your mass data table in your interactive lab notes. When you record your measurements, make sure to include the units you used. The next measurement we'll practice is length, or how long something is. Scientists measure length in centimeters or meters. Smaller items are measured in centimeters. If you're using a ruler or a small tape measure that shows centimeters, you'll want to measure smaller items, like a pencil, a notebook, or the width of your desk. Larger items are measured in meters. If you have a longer tape measure that also shows meters, you can measure bigger items, like the length of a table, the height of a door, or even the distance across a room. Trying to measure a whole room with a ruler in centimeters would take forever, and using a meter-long tape to measure a pencil might not be very accurate. Based on your tool, pick 3 items to measure. I've selected a pencil, a cucumber, and a fork. Pause the video here to select your items and write down each of your objects in the data table. Once you have your items, hypothesize the length of each object. A fingernail is about 1 centimeter across, and a baseball bat is about 1 meter long. What do you predict the lengths of your 3 items will be? Find a flat surface, like a table, and stretch your measuring tool straight along the length. If the tool is bent, your measurement might be longer than the item really is. Then place your item right next to the tape measure. Make sure you start measuring from the 0 mark. Sometimes rulers start before that mark, so keep this in mind when measuring. Also, make sure you measure to the very end of your object. If you need to, you can round to the nearest 1/10 of a centimeter or meter. Record the length in your data table. Be sure to include the units you used. Repeat this procedure to measure the length of your next 2 items. Be sure to leave your tape measure on a stable surface the whole time. As you complete each measurement, fill out the measurements in your length data table in your interactive lab notes, including the unit of measurement you used. Finally, we'll measure volume, or the amount of space an object takes up. Liquid items are measured in milliliters or liters, and solid items are measured in cubic centimeters. Measure smaller volumes of liquid in milliliters. For example, if you're measuring the volume of water in a cup, milliliters are perfect because they're small, precise units. On the other hand, measure larger volumes in liters. If you're measuring the amount of water in a pool, you might use liters because the volume is much larger. To start, we'll practice reading accurate volume measurements by filling our graduated cylinder with 50 milliliters of water. This will be the first measurement to fill out in your data table. When measuring the volume of the water, be sure to read the bottom curve of the meniscus, or water line. For example, we can see that the bottom of the meniscus is at 50 milliliters. When you're measuring your water, be sure to read the bottom of the meniscus at eye level. Place your graduated cylinder on a solid, flat surface. This helps keep the water level even. Then slowly fill it with water until the water reaches the 50 milliliter line. When reading the water level, leave your graduated cylinder on the table and get down to eye level with the cup. Looking from above or the side can make the water appear higher or lower than it really is. Once you've filled your graduated cylinder with 50 milliliters of water, note this as your first measurement in the volume data table in your interactive lab notes. But how do we measure the volume of solid objects? Since volume is how much space something takes up, we can multiply the length times the width times the height. This gives us the volume in cubic centimeters, which is equivalent to the milliliters used to measure liquid volume. But here's where things get tricky. Irregularly shaped solid objects, like this screw, can be difficult to measure in volume. We can't multiply length by width by height because this is not a cube. Instead, we'll use a technique called the displacement method to measure the volume of irregular solid objects. Just like the water level rises when you get in a bathtub, or the liquid in a cup rises when you add ice cubes, the water level in a container will rise by an amount equal to the volume of whatever is submerged in it. Let's take a look at an example. Reading the bottom of the meniscus in this graduated cylinder, we can see that the volume of water is at 25 milliliters. If I added a rock, the volume space taken up by the rock will move, or displace, the water line. It now reads 35 milliliters. This means that the volume of the rock took up 10 milliliters of space because 35 milliliters total minus 25 milliliters of water equals a 10 milliliter rock. The rock is a solid though, so when I record this measurement in my data table, I'll change the units to be cubic centimeters. My solid objects are a screw and a quarter. Pause and choose two small objects of your own. These should fit within the 50 milliliters mark on your graduated cylinder. Write down each of the objects in your table, then hypothesize the volume of each object. Record your predictions in the data table in your interactive lab notes. Start with your graduated cylinder full of 50 milliliters of water. Tilt your graduated cylinder slowly without spilling any of the water. Then carefully place your item inside and let it gently slide to the bottom. Be careful not to let any water splash. Return your graduated cylinder to the table and look at the water line from eye level. The water level will be higher. Record the new water level after your object is fully submerged. To find the volume of the object, subtract the initial water level from the new water level. Record this number in your data table and record the units as cubic centimeters. Repeat this procedure to measure the volume of your final item. Be sure to leave your graduated cylinder on a stable surface to read the measurement. Fill out the measurement in your volume data table in your interactive lab notes. Throughout the lab, you made predictions about the mass, length, and volume of each item you measured. Take some time to reflect on these hypotheses. Were they correct? If not, how close were your predictions? Be sure to answer all of the conclusion questions in your interactive lab notes. As we went through the lesson today, you got a chance to sharpen your experimental science skills by taking accurate measurements in the metric system. You'll use these measurement skills in many of the labs throughout this course, so feel free to practice measuring some extra items on your own. Now that I'm confident in my measuring skills, I think I'm ready to tackle Justin's cookie recipe. I'm Caroline, and remember, life is full of wonders, so keep learning and don't ever stop wondering. Hey, hey.